of Dublin against Kerry, but it turned out it was the Castle Bar in Tralee. Tommy Walsh was there to make it even more confusing. It was the Kilkenny Tommy Walsh. Tommy Walsh was there. Listen, they one of the great things actually is we're bringing hurling people to football strongholds, football people to hurling strongholds, and there's an awful lot of love for them.
That's
when they
it.
Go there.
It's working. I have to say, we used to do that years ago. Stopped doing it because it wasn't working.
Now we're bringing the biggest name.
I think it's a sign of the growth.
I think the only way it works, is, you know, when you go into a pub and they have those sort of all-time posters, so like they have the team of the millennium poster that all great pubs have, or they'll have like that Kerry greatest Kerry 15 poster. If you bring someone from that to Kilkenny, they will appreciate it, and likewise Tommy Walsh will be on that Kilkenny poster in the pubs in Kerry.
Yeah, so far we've only gone with people from Kilkenny and Eddie Brennan and Tommy Walsh, so
it's hard to move past that.
It works that way. Yeah.
So we're going to bring you Tommy Walsh down in Kerry in Tralee over the next couple of days, but Jason Sherlock and Dara O'Kaneda were there as well, and they were reminiscing about, well, the greatest rivalry in Gaelic football, and also looking ahead to probably the most anticipated game of Gaelic football we've had in many a year, Dublin against Kerry on Sunday. That's coming up after 8 o'clock. In this hour, Rory O'Connor is going to join me in studio. Andy Farrell, just the one change to the Ireland team to play the All Blacks in the second test on Saturday. And John Giles is back after a 2-week break. He's sort of like the modern day footballers. There was once upon a time it was 3 months off for the summer. Mm. You go on the lash, come back 2 stone overweight. Not now. Do you follow footballers on Instagram?
I've tried to not.
Okay, it's probably for the best.
Yeah, they're all there running around fields on holidays in like Barbados or somewhere.
It's mostly Irish footballers I follow, but like James McLean never stops. James McLean plays a League One game, and then that night is up boxing at 1 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah.
Like just insane energy levels. But they're all at it. Jeff Hendrick, they're all there with their private trainers on their summer holidays. Mm. It's not much crack, is it?
Yeah, well, professional athletes.
Professional athletes. You know, anyways, it was different to John Giles today, but he's back. He's taking just a 2-week break, and he's going to be chatting about some of the transfers and what effect he thinks it'll have as we build up towards the new season. As I say, 53106 is the text number. Richie McCormack, I apologise, I'm very rude. Are you there, Richie?
How are you, Nathan? You well?
I am very well. I'm very well. And I didn't even get a chance to introduce him, as always. Mick McCarthy is here.
Just interrupting like I always do. Sorry about that, everybody.
Do you know what I want tonight, Richie? Do you know what I want tonight, Mick? All I want in this show is happy talk. A little bit of Captain Sensible. That's what I want.
No, just bopping away.
Nice. Do you know what that song reminds me of? Reminds me of this day 40 years ago, Mick, when it was number one in the UK charts. It's a really terrible song, isn't it?
It's pretty shite, it has to be honest.
Much better on this day 40 years ago, as number one was in the US. A much better song. You were working as a waitress in a cocktail bar. This was a great idea. We had to start dancing live on air. And you can't help but dance when Don't You Want Me Baby comes on. That's a great tune. You like that one, Richie? He looks a little bit of the human league.
Banger. Yeah.
You like what was number one in Ireland on this day 40 years ago?
What was number one in Ireland?
Oh, I know.
Come on.
Hey, lady.
Let's hold hands. Hey, lady. You
made it. Bit of Charlene.
The Dustin version, as with all versions.
Do we have the Dustin version?
We actually don't, no.
How can Dustin's we find the Dustin version?
I've never been to Meath.
Shaking my head here, Arthur.
Sound quality. Artist says sound quality was. No, that's just the song. That's Dustin doing
stuff off YouTube.
I've never been to Meath. Oh, listen. There's only one other song we could really play for today, though, is there? There's only one other song we could play. Richie McCormack. The big 4-0. Congratulations.
How about to celebrate my birthday than a song about Nelson Mandela being in prison? That's great. Cheers, lads. Nice one.
It's not a song about that. It's just to him.
Pretty much it is, yeah. He's still locked up at the time. He's looking to get him out.
And he's been wished a happy birthday, the same as you are. You're locked up in that bedroom.
I am, pretty much.
Giving
this
us
is my
the
Robin
news
Island.
Every night. Oh, where do you go from there?
where do you go from there? In your 40 years, Richie, has there ever been a comparison quite like it?
No, I don't think so. In all of my 40 years, I don't think I've ever compared my home to Robben Island. But here we are. Maybe Winnie's waiting for me outside and walking me up the road. Who knows?
Well done for coming into work. Did the kids surprise you bright and early this morning?
No, once again, I think I was right before everybody else. It was a case of trying to get everybody up for cool camps, as has been the mode of the week. So yeah, and there's been a case of COVID among one of them as well. So that's added to the gaiety of the week. So yeah, great crack.
Richie, very disappointed that we had to go the musical route, because of course we wanted to go the football route, but we were devastated to find out that both World Cup semi-finals were not played on the 7th and 8th, as they should have been, but both played on the 8th, which meant that we couldn't go and reminisce about
Harald Schumacher,
or Rossi, or Harald Schumacher. Disappointing.
I know, yeah. One played after another on the day, which is kind of... You kind of miss that now, wouldn't you? Because they're kind of played in two different days. They're both played on the same day. I was actually listening to a podcast recently which was talking about that, and the fact that they still put a Top of the Pops up opposite Schumacher and Platini and all that kind of good stuff over on ITV. But yeah, there you go. 40. And look at me now. Look at me now.
I won't lie, Richie. When I saw it on your Instagram, I said, Richie McCormack can't be younger than me. And sure enough, he is. It's outrageous.
I am, yeah.
He's not younger than me.
Ah, Mick, it's coming. You want your big 40th as well, do you?
I won't be in that day.
No? Well done, Richie, for coming into work.
3 years away.
3 years?
Are you afraid you'll get egged or something?
Yeah, you think it's like being back in school. You get a wedgie or something.
I'd be afraid of this, Richie, is the truth. This would be a problem.
Well, Richie, congratulations. Sure, we have a virtual cake. A virtual cake we will hand over. If you were in the office, we'd have an actual cake, of course. But it's a virtual
cake. Of course, cake, which I'd have paid for myself.
Yeah, possibly. Donations welcome. You've still got to do your job. Still got to do your job, Richie. You've still got to get through the news round. So
much like those professional footballers, Nathan, I'm a pro.
Exactly. Or you could be the Ayatollah of this.
100% I am, yeah.
The news round is brought to you with Gillette Labs for an effortless finish to your day. And here is the birthday boy himself, Richie McCormack.
Welcome. Mac Hansen replaces Keith Earls on the wing for Ireland's second test with the All Blacks, the only change from last week's defeat at Eden Park. Jonathan Sexton has been cleared to play after taking a knock to the head last week, and he continues at out half. Scott Barrett switches from blindside to the All Blacks second row with Sam Whitelock ruled out through concussion. Dalton Papali comes in on the open side of the New Zealand scrum. The game will be played under the roof of the Forsyth Barr Stadium in Dunedin, something Andy Farrell believes will make a difference.
We all know it suits the All Blacks. We know that, I mean, every game I've watched play at the stadium has been fantastic, you know. It's always quick. When we've been there in the past, I think I've coached a good few times now, and it's always been quick, and the atmosphere is fantastic, you know. It's not the biggest of stadiums, but the atmosphere is electric in there because of the roof, etc. So I expect more of what we've seen in Super Rugby, and when the All Blacks have played there in the past, whether it be against the Lions or any other international side, it'd be quick and the ball will be fizzing around, I'm sure.
Keith Wood was on last night.
Yeah, talking about Dunedin, said it was his favourite venue to play rugby.
Why?
And because of the atmosphere and so kind of what Farrell was alluding to there, but actually more because he was kind of saying they're kind of an alternative crowd down in Dunedin, and
the Galway of New Zealand.
They might come out and boo the All Blacks and cheer on Ireland. You wouldn't know what to expect from them, he kind of says. So it's just this kind of eclectic atmosphere that he relished, and that'll be right up Keith Wood's alley, all right, as a rugby player, I would imagine. But do you know what? Hearing that now 2 days in a row has made me think I'd ever really differentiated between all the New Zealand venues in my head, but I'm looking forward to that aspect of Saturday morning now.
Lads, just to correct you there, it's not been a good few minutes for Nelson Mandela, it's got to be said. Happy birthday was in honour of Martin Luther King's birthday, not Mandela's, says Kieran in Dublin.
This remains my Robin Island.
Please don't go any further down this. I was thinking we should have had an entire musical news round in honour of Richie, and we could have just gone with the obvious Return of the Mac for the Ireland team news.
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
That's good.
It took me a second there, actually. Yeah.
You would be no help in this. We could have gone with that.
That's very true, actually, yeah.
Have we got my Zinedine Zidane song for later?
We do, yeah. Well, we don't.
Richie, you have heard this Zinedine Zidane song, have you?
Have I?
Have we got it there?
No, we don't have it.
We don't have it there.
No,
you're right, it's going to be there in 1 minute. This is a new development. It's got about 8 million views on YouTube, so it's not going to be new to everybody. I presume that this was something my kids had somehow discovered. It's the only song they now play in the car. It's incredibly catchy and may well be the greatest song of all time. Without giving it too big a build-up, we're going to play it in 2 minutes.
I'm used to this kind of crap when Johnny Ward is presenting and anything could be thrown at me, but I thought I'd, you know, at least when it's Johnny, it's like, I know, it that's part of the fun. On nights like this, Nathan just throwing crap at me here.
For the next song, we could have gone with the Water Boy, the Water Boys, Bang on the Ear, for the next news story, is what I'm going with, Richie, unless you've got a better one.
Where's Your Head At? Could have been another one from Basement Jacks. World Rugby has defended its head injury assessment protocol following incidents involving Irish players in New Zealand. Jeremy Loughman was allowed to return to the field of play against New Zealand Maori despite appearing obviously groggy, while questions persist over Sexton. World Rugby issued a clarification today saying failing the HIA-1 on-field assessment does not automatically mean a player has sustained a concussion. If a player does not pass either of the two tests in the following 36 hours, then they have to sit out the next game. Progressive Rugby, who have been campaigning for safe rugby, particularly as it pertains to the head, are not happy with this clarification either.
Yeah, I think we're going to be talking to World Rugby on this. Obviously, it was a big talking point on the show last night. Johnny Sexton is in the team. Rory O'Connor coming up at 7:30. He said even from a PR point of view, maybe the right decision would have been to leave Johnny Sexton out of this. Though I do wonder what you're setting in that case if you just decide, even though a player has passed the concussion protocols, that you're not going to play him.
Should we really not be playing people for PR reasons as well? Like, I mean, that's a coach's decision. Should we pick a rugby team, and a doctor's decision should be about the welfare of them? I'm not saying that the coaches don't have an impact in that welfare, but presuming there's no pressure being put on the doctor's independent assessment, and there isn't, then, you know, Andy Farrell has to just pick who's available to him. And if, you know, I just don't know where that goes if you start saying, oh, well, it doesn't look good, we're going to drop Johnny Sexton. Because then I don't know what you're doing then. Are you holding up your hands and saying that the system doesn't work?
I have a lot of sympathy for Johnny Sexton in all of this.
Yeah, as usual, caught in the middle of these concussion stories. Mm. Like, it's been going on for 10 years now with him.
I'm going to play you this, all right? Like, this is going to change your entire evening. I heard this about a week ago in the car and I thought, that's a very annoying song. And then I heard it for the second time and now it's permanently in my head. It could be one of the greatest sports songs of all time. So it's by Vaudeville Smash. It's called Zinedine Zidane and it's featuring Les Murray. You got to stick with this. After 10 seconds, you're going to say, turn this off. But then a minute in, you're going to think, please play more.
Of Marseille, two Algerian immigrants awaited the birth of their fifth child. Later that day, a star was born.
Don't just zoom in on me. Keep them all on screen.
Cristiano Ronaldo, Wayne Rooney, Verón. Suarez, Van Basten, Gianluigi Buffon, Xavi, Iniesta, Drogba, Hazard, Tevez, Schweinsteiger, Steven, Gerrard, Alessandro Del Piero, Neymar, Forlan, Özil, Nakata, Jean-Pierre Papin,
Malin,
Van Persie,
James MacArthur, what a player. Beaks,
Scholes, but the strongest of them all.
The second verse is the best part, when he does all the Brazilians and rolls all the oars.
Maybe later.
Ramirez, Ronaldo. Richie, you getting the seal of approval?
sorry, my it was a very, very crackly line there. I'm not sure I was doing it justice.
Turn it back up again. Sorry. Turn it back up again.
Do not.
Oh, God. I can't believe James McCarthy got in there.
I thought Ferrari.
Lionel Messi, Gareth Bale, Cure.
How do you even come up with this?
Who was that for Gareth Bale?
Joe.
Castillo, Everton
legend. Manchester City, Everton legend.
Mandzukic, Mario Balotelli, Zlatan Ibrahimovic.
You're very excited about Zlatan.
Mateus, Shevchenko, Cantona.
Play twice. And Ronaldo,
Mario Rivaldo, Rubinho, Ramirez, Kaká.
That's the best bit.
Falcao, Frank Ribery.
Ramirez.
Cahill Company.
I don't know what their criteria for getting in was, aside from maybe rhyming. I thought John Giles might get in there. very disappointing.
No Irish players. Disgraceful. Is Roy Keane in there?
I didn't hear Roy Keane. It might be the best football song of all time. Yeah. That's next Thursday. Next Thursday we're doing the best football song of all time.
Yeah, it's going to be okay. The memories.
We'll get Ian Brody on again.
We're going to start a fire.
Sweet.
George Best is mentioned. We had Ian Brody on at Electric Picnic.
Yeah, he did the picnic with us a couple years ago, yeah.
Yeah.
Richie, really, who did that remind you of? We were trying to figure it out earlier. Is it Ian Jury? Who is the...
Oh, that there?
Yeah.
Oh, God. In terms of reeling off names.
In terms of that delivery. It doesn't matter.
Yeah, a little bit. It's really like mid-90s Europop, Mr. Scatman John stuff in there.
Scatman John.
Scatman John is the one that we'll go with, yes. It is a Scatman's world after all.
I don't know how we follow that up. Yeah. There's a lot of live football on tonight, Richie.
What's your song for that?
Yeah, there's a 7 o'clock start in Northwest Wales. European Sun, but they'll have it underground. They've just kicked off in Northwest Wales in the first of this evening's two Conference League qualifiers involving League of Ireland sides. Sligo Rovers already 1-0 down, away to Cymru Premier runners-up Ballytown. Lasana Mendez with the goal for the hosts there. There's a 7:45 start at the Ryan McBride Brandywell, where Derry City entertained three-time Latvian champions Riga. And there's one game in the SSE or Tristy Premier Division tonight. There's a first start for a new Bohemian signing, Josh Kerr, at the back, away to UCD. Kickoff at Belfield at 7:45. And one other League of Ireland line tonight as well. Lincoln City have confirmed the signing from Shamrock Rovers of Danny Mandrew.
Right. That's obviously expected, but also a huge loss for Shamrock Rovers. He's probably been their best player this season.
It's mad that League of Ireland clubs, like, you know, Rovers are obviously embarking on a busy time of year, Champions League and on. It's right at the exact time where they start losing their players to English clubs as well.
I know, Richie, obviously the league has always lost its best players to English football, but this summer has taken it to a whole other level where almost every team has lost its best young player or is going to.
This is a dangerous period for the league whereby it's at a level where it's getting noticed by scouts and teams across the water at a certain level, and even if you want to go to, as far as Italy in terms of James Abanqua. But with that, it means that the contractual situation within the League of Ireland, which isn't great, is being taken advantage of. And, you know, clubs are within their rights to take advantage of that. They're going to get a good player on the cheap. But similarly, it shows the catch-22 that the clubs are in, that they can't afford to give these guys longer contracts, and yet they risk losing them for a pittance. And so the best years and the best money from an asset, essentially, is going to be made by a team abroad. We're going to see it with Abanqua and Udinese and St. Pat's. We're going to see it with Mandroyu, who'll probably head on from Lincoln if he applies himself and does well there for a couple of years. Dara Burns, MK Dons as well, is a massive loss for Pat's. Ross Tierney has been a massive loss for Bowes, going over to Motherwell in the past 12 months too.
A lot of speculation.
It's only going to keep
Dawson
happening, unfortunately. Yeah, he's probably going to go to a League One side himself over the course of this break, maybe, I would imagine.
It's a real shame. And listen, I know Johnny Ward was on this morning. I think Jerry was describing him as John the Baptist about his relationship with the League of Ireland. And there is a lot of good things happening in the league, but you can't lose your best players mid-season all of the time. Like Danny Mandreau, I know he's injured at the moment, but like Rovers, in all likelihood, are going to have at least another... six, seven European games before even qualifying for a group stage, and he could have been so important for that. So I think it's a huge blow, obviously, particularly with Jack Byrne still out injured as well. So we'll have more of that, I'm sure, over the coming couple of days. So England got the Euros underway last night, ground out a 1-0 victory. It was tough enough going at times. Northern Ireland, who qualified for the first time ever, are starting out tonight.
Yeah, they go up against Ada Hegerberg and Norway in their opening Group A encounter in Euro 2022. The North plunged into controversy, of course, back in April when manager Kenny Shields accused women players of being more emotional than men. But captain Marissa Coughlin insists they're all singing from the same hymn sheet by now.
Ourselves and Kenny, we've always had a fantastic relationship. And, you know, we speak about this the family atmosphere that we have. You know, any one of our players can go to Kenny and talk about how they're feeling, how they're doing, anything. You know, he's you know, we see him as almost like a father figure. He's been there, he's made our dreams come true. He's basically got us here, and we can't deny that fact that he hasn't done that, because 3 years ago, before he came in, we were in the fourth and fifth seeds in every group. The girls are just delighted that we're here and feel very lucky that we got a manager like Kenny that came in and took over when he did.
Someone from Waterford needs to rewrite the Zidane song as John Milan.
Now you're talking.
Wow, next time Waterford get to an All-Ireland.
Could you name 70 hurlers?
Oh, that'd be perfect. Yeah. Is this why Nathan got transferred to the sports department in his early years as a DJ, says Owen? So I'm just bringing you the good stuff. You didn't get that in Phantom early morning, did you, Richie?
No, that's probably why. No, I'm not going to go there.
Don't go there.
No, I won't go there. No. We just had a load of Kasabian, which probably wasn't much better than that. And Pigeon Detectives and the like.
The good old days. Wimbledon. I'm not sure if you've seen this, Richie.
I'm seeing it. Yeah. I was going to get to it there. Rafa Nadal is about to hold a press conference at Wimbledon. His name popped up on the schedule there in the media center. Rather unexpectedly, he completed 44 minutes of a knockaround on the practice courts earlier today. It was revealed by Marca that he'd suffered a 7mm abdominal tear, which of course he was struggling with during yesterday's 5-set victory over Taylor Fritz in the quarterfinals. Nadal, due to play Nick Kyrgios in tomorrow's semifinals, he's expected, although not confirmed just yet, but he is widely expected to be pulling out of Wimbledon, allowing Nick Kyrgios through to the final with an extra day's rest to take on perhaps Novak Djokovic in that decider. So Nadal out of Wimbledon, we think we'll get confirmation of that hopefully in the next minute or two.
Oh, it's sickening in so many ways for Taylor Fritz as well, who was brilliant last night, and it felt as though it was on the verge of this breakthrough appearance in a Wimbledon semi-final. And Nadal, you sort of hoped, Richie, that because he was able to play on, that it couldn't be as bad as it looked earlier in the match. But obviously, look, a 7-inch tear, there's no getting over that, and creates another massive story of Nick Kyrgios in a Wimbledon final.
7mm tear, we must stipulate. 7-inch tear. Sorry. I don't think we'd be talking about it being alive this evening if that was the case. But yes, it was quite obvious from the first set yesterday that he was struggling with it. And he went off for a trainer break during the course of the second, which is, you know, it's not unusual for players, but he was grimacing, wasn't able to serve properly and all this kind of stuff. But still managed to get through a 5-setter against an 11 seed like Taylor Fritz. It's just sad because this men's draw has been snake bit from the jump. When you think of Matteo Berrettini having to pull out after testing positive COVID, he probably, given the way that side of the draw panned out, we would have been talking about him in the semi-final tomorrow, but he had to pull out through COVID. Marin Cilic had to pull out through COVID. Roberto Bautista Agut had to pull out through COVID. And now we got Nadal at the second last hurdle having to pull out through an abdominal injury, and he has confirmed that in the last moment or two. Unfortunately, I'm here because of the pull out of the tournament. Does he got a tear in his abdominal muscle? Said he thought all day about his decision, and his calendar slam hopes for the year, of course, are now dead. He says he made the decision because he couldn't feel he can win two more matches over the course of the next 3 days at Wimbledon. So Nadal definitely out of Wimbledon. Pretty sad story it is too. Nick Kyrgios through to a first ever Grand Slam singles final, which is going to be some occasion to say the least, given the news that's been around him this week.
On the ladies' side, there's going to be a new winner.
Yeah, there will be a new winner, a new name on the Venus Rosewater dish on Saturday afternoon. Elena Rybakina beat 2019 champion Simona Halep this afternoon in straight sets. Halep's serve completely crumbling for her this afternoon. And she sets up a meeting, Rybakina, with Ons Jabeur. Third seed Jabeur needed 3 sets to beat Tatiana Maria earlier in the day. And she becomes the first ever African to reach a Grand Slam final. The Tunisian hopes many more from the Arab world and beyond as well can follow in her wake.
I want to go bigger, inspire many more generation. You know, Tunisia is connected to the Arab world, is connected to the African continent. You know, the area, we want to see more players. You know, it's not like Europe or any other countries. It's I want to see more players from my country, from the Middle East, you know, from Africa. And I think we didn't believe enough at a certain point that we can do it. And now I'm just trying to show that, and hopefully people are getting inspired.
All right, we got to leave it there for the news round, a musical special news round to honor Richie McCormack's 40th birthday.
Happy birthday.
Enjoy your evening, Richie.
Thank you.
Enjoy your evening.
Thank you, lads. I will look forward to watching the North and Norway as a birthday treat.
Okay, well, you go enjoy that. Mick, thank you as always. We'll talk to you in a while.
Thank you, Nathan.
All right, time for the cash machine.
Your chance to win big. News Talk
Summer Cash Machine. So another winner today in the Summer Cash Machine, which makes it 8 in a row. Another big number for you to remember tonight. €25,250.73. That is €25,250.